Well, welcome to First Wednesday. I'm glad you're here. I really am from my heart. This is so exciting to see our campuses come together and to celebrate Jesus and worship the Lord. This begins, for those of you that are new to New Life Church, this really begins officially the new season for us. And kind of like we're ramping up as the, you know, the school system goes. That's kind of the way New Life goes. So June and July, we're just kind of out there somewhere and, still love Jesus. But everybody's going everywhere. But then the 1st of August rolls around and the seasons begin to change. And kids go back to school next week, I understand. Is that true? Can I get a witness tonight? Amen. And it does represent a new beginning. And so tonight, I'm just glad you're here to begin this new season with your church family. I think it'd be good if we give some honor and love to our campus pastors, to Pastor Jim and Camilla, Joe and Kathleen and Bart and Lori, Eric and Emma, and Pastor Hector and Gladys. Man, these guys are amazing. It's just so beautiful to see our family come together like this. And so, again, we just love you guys so much. I'm excited about this season. I love what's happening, this 21 days of prayer beginning Monday. I really, really look forward to these times. And so Monday rolls around, and we're going to help you with that to get set up to where we're all tracking together in an intentional and intensive time of seeking God and hearing from Him and beginning the season with prayer. Because how many of you know you can do your best, but your best is never enough? Because life is going to throw you some curveballs, and you're going to go like, I'm good, but I'm not that good. We need the power of the Holy Spirit. We need the wisdom of God. We need the power of Jesus in our lives. And so, therefore, we take these 21 days for spiritual breakthroughs. We're going to seek the Lord. We're going to commit ourselves to Him to begin the season right. And so what's red hot in my heart this month is just going back to the year of the Bible, reminding all of you that, you know, we began in January, and we felt like the Lord said, just, we've got to bring our church family back to the Word of God in a new, fresh way. And man, we've got hundreds and hundreds of you that are reading through the Bible for the very first time in your life. I mean, literally from Genesis to Revelation. And, sometimes you get off a day or two. It's okay. Just get back up. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Because the key is to get the Word of God in your mind and your heart. And if we're all doing this together, there's something that unifies our heart when we're reading the same passages, like Jim referred to Psalms 29. Well, a lot of us today and read that. So we're coming here tonight, and we're reading this together, and it's a powerful thing that's happening in our church family, what's happening in your family. So let's stay in the Word. Let's stay in the Word. Because, listen, our world needs truth. We've got a lot of opinions out there, but we need truth, and truth comes from the Bible. That is truth. That is the guide, the roadmap to life, and our world needs more of the Word. You agree? I want to share tonight just a few things, two words. One word was given to me during my quiet time back in May. It was a word that the Lord gave me to wrap up my season. And in fact, if I had my phone, I would show you. I literally put these three words on my screensaver, and it's been there for 3 months now. And it's three words: stop the chase. Would you say that with me? Stop the chase. And we'll talk about that in a second. The other word came to me last week in my devotions, and on the 27th of July. And interesting enough, Jesus gave me this word to begin the new season. But they kind of dovetail together, and I felt like the Lord wanted me to share out of what I'm experiencing and what the Lord's doing in me. And I think it might connect to you. I really do. I think the word may connect to you. So we're going to read from the scriptures in just a second. So if you brought your Bibles, open them or turn them on your phone to, and don't look at your text, by the way. 2 Samuel 2:19 is where we will begin the first one, 2 Samuel 2:19. Then the second word, we're going to jump over to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. How many of you are married? Can I see your hand, the married folks? Okay. How many of you got a serious person? You're not married, but it's kind of serious. Raise your hand. Come on, don't be ashamed. It's okay. Raise your hand. Okay. All right. Good. There's this thing called the chase that psychologists talk about a lot, where it's a weird thing about a human being that we, Lydia and I, especially in the early days, we would do this. Don't do it much anymore because I don't have enough energy, but it used to be that, you know, it's like I would just kind of ignore her to get her to chase me. You know what I'm talking about? And then when I felt her love and her affection, but then when she got me, and it's like, okay, I need 3 feet. That's good, that's good. Or she would do the same thing. There was this chase thing that couples do. And it's normal. It really is. And it's kind of like once you get it, it's like the dog that chases the vehicle. Once it gets the vehicle, it goes, now what do I do with it? It's kind of the same thing. There's this thing called the chase that the scripture points out to us. And I want to just read it to you, and then we'll talk about it. Again, the Lord gave me this in May 23rd. 2 Samuel 2:19, he chased Abner and did not turn to the right or to the left in his pursuit. Everybody say pursuit. His pursuit of him. Abner glanced back and said, is that you, Asahel? Yes, it is, Asahel replied. Abner said to him, turn to the right or the left. Seize one of the younger soldiers and take whatever you can from him. But Asahel would not stop chasing him. Once again, Abner warned Asahel, stop chasing me. Why should I strike you to the ground? How could I ever look your brother Joab in the face? But Asahel refused to turn away. He refused to turn away. So Abner hit him in the stomach with the butt of his spear. And the spear went through his body, and he fell and died right there. And they all came to the place where Asahel had fallen and died. They stopped the chase. So I want you to imagine this happening. So you got one guy, he's running, and he's saying, dude, hey, stop chasing, because if you don't stop chasing me, I'm going to kill you, dude. No, I'm going to get you. No, they're running, there's the chase going on. He says, you know, stop in the pursuit. No, I'm going to get you. And then what happens? Now, that, I thought about that. If you put the butt of the spear through somebody's belly, that's serious stuff. And in that moment, in that man's life, he would not quit chasing that he thought was going to bring him fulfillment and pleasure and put an end to a season, because he wanted to kill him to get revenge. Now, listen carefully. This is what I felt like the Lord was saying to me wrapping up the season back in May. You got to make sure that your heart, listen to what your heart is chasing. And I'm not necessarily talking about bad things. We can talk about those in a second. But I'm just talking about things that we think, if I ever get that, that is going to make me fulfilled. That's going to make me happy. That's going to be everything I've ever wanted in my life, is if I get that home, that car, that person, that job, that whatever it may be. And so we pursue it, and we pursue it with all of our hearts. And again, there's nothing wrong with having good ambition in life. That's not what I'm referring to. What I heard the Lord say to me is there are relationships in your life that you're trying to repair that relationship and make it right, because if you ever make it right, then it's all going to be good again. But I'm going to tell you, have you found out yet that a lot of relationships in life you can't ever repair? That's why the Bible says, as much as it is within yourself, live at peaceable with all people, because it's not always possible to live at peace with everybody. Sometimes you're going to have a friend or a loved one or a coworker that you get estranged from, and it's never repaired in this life. But if you're not careful, your heart is always craving, pursuing. And if I can ever make this right, then all will be good in the earth. All will be well with my soul. And what I felt like the Lord was saying to me, and I want to pass it on to you. And I want to ask you a few questions along these lines. Is there something in your life presently, let's talk about the good, that you find yourself saying that thing, that relationship, that person, that dream, that ambition, that's not necessarily bad, but I'm really looking at that to fulfill me like only Jesus can? Is there something in my life that I need to say, wait a second, I need to stop the chase because I'm wasting time and energy? How many of you know when you chase, it takes a lot of energy? And some of you, you know what I'm talking about. It's not a bad thing. You're chasing this career, this pathway, or this relationship, and you're burning up all this energy, all this passion in your heart. But you never feel satisfied. I hear the Lord saying to us tonight, as we begin this season, listen to the whisper of the Spirit about those things that you need to stop the chase. For 3 months, I've prayed this prayer. 3 months. I've asked the Lord, Jesus, show me. What is it in my life that I need to, wait a second. I need to stop chasing that. And really, the only thing I need to be is a God chaser. I need to chase God. I need to pursue his heart and seek first his kingdom. And then all these other things will be added to me. And so through the summer months and during my sabbatical, my downtime, I kept praying, Lord, reveal to me. I began to make notes, jot down. What are some things in my life that they're not evil, they're not bad, but they're just, I'm putting too much energy into them, chasing them. And I need to just turn it over to God. That's a funny thing. Like with Jonathan, my son, we've told you the story, but him and I were estranged for 8 months, and I kept trying to pursue, making it right. John, you got to talk to me. But he wouldn't talk to me. And that made me even more ticked off. It's like, I'm your dad, boy, you know. For 8 months, I tried to encourage my wife to talk to my son, to talk to me. And she said, listen, the Lord gave me a word. The word was for me to shut my mouth. So I'm going to shut my mouth. Yeah, but you need to answer. No. Listen, he's God, you're not. I'm going to obey him, not you. So for 8 months this went on, and I was pursuing, chasing after that relationship that was broken. I got to make it right for me to feel good about me. See how sick that is? In the end of the eighth month, you know what happened. We talked about it a few months ago, but we reconciled, not in the way that I ever would. Finally, when I gave up, and I didn't say anything. I shut my mouth and let my wife just let her be herself. All of a sudden, I get this phone call I hadn't heard from John in 8 months. Saying, hey, Dad, we'd like to come move in with y'all for a couple weeks with our three little children. It ended up being 3 months. So the Lord forced us into close proximity so him and I could kind of just become, you know, friends again and dad and son again. Isn't it strange? The thing I was chasing after my way, the moment I let it go, the Lord brought it into my life and made it better, way better than I could have ever done. I don't know. I just, especially some of us that are type A, we're driven, we just go after stuff. What is it that Jesus may be saying, in order for you to move into your new season, you've got to stop chasing some stuff. Now, there are some things that, let's just be honest, there's some things we can get in our lives that can be bad. And we know there, it's a bad friendship. Every time I get around this guy, he brings me down. But somehow, if I could ever have that person, they're going to fulfill me and make me satisfied. And oh, it's going to be heaven on earth. Yeah, I've watched that. You know, you finally get it, you go, oh my gosh, really? A relationship that's toxic, it's not good. A friendship that you know is not good. It's not godly. It doesn't lift you up. It brings you down every single time, but you're chasing after it. And it may be some kind of addiction. You know, I'm pursuing that. I got to have that. Because if I get that, that's really going to fulfill my heart. That's really basically idol worship. That's why the Bible in the Old Testament and New talks so much. God, Yahweh says, don't worship graven images. Why? Images can be a car. It can be a person. It can be any kind of image, pornography. It can be any kind of image that if I have that, that's going to fulfill me inside here. So I'm pursuing it with all my might to get it, because then I'm going to be fulfilled and satisfied. And when Jesus says, I'm the only one that can bring real satisfaction to your soul, because what you're craving inside is not anything external. It's not flesh and blood. It's not an idol. It's spirit. You're wanting God. How many of you know there's this place in your heart only for God? It's reserved for God. It's sacred. It's sacred space. And God just says, I want you to fill your heart with me and nothing else. I got a couple of scriptures we're going to put up on the screen about pursuing, chasing after the right things. Let's put it up there. 2 Timothy 2:22. It says, flee the evil desires of youth and pursue righteousness. Everybody say pursue. Chase after righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Let's go to the next. I'm just going to run through these scriptures, so just keep them going. Next scripture, please. But you, man of God, flee, run from all this, and pursue, chase after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Let's keep them going. Proverbs 21:21, whoever pursues righteousness and love finds life, prosperity, and honor. See, you got to chase after the right things. Let's go to the next one. Oh, this is a good one. Hosea 2:7, she will chase after her lovers. This is Hosea's wife. She will chase after her lovers but not catch them. She will look for them but not find them. Then she will say, I will go back to my husband as at first, for then I was better off than now. And what I just said, when I jotted that scripture down, I just asked, are there any lovers in my heart? Is there something that I'm pursuing rather than God that I love? Not necessarily an evil, bad thing, but is there things that I'm pursuing that are becoming my lovers that I'm loving more than God, that I'm giving my heart to more than God? Proverbs 28:19 says, those who work their land will have abundant food, but those who chase fantasies will have their fill of poverty. Are there any fantasies that I'm chasing after in my mind or my heart? And then lastly, Isaiah 1:23, you rulers are rebels, partners with thieves. They all love bribes and chase after gifts. I just, when I read that scripture, I went, just evaluate your heart, James. Are you chasing after bribes? Not necessarily, I'm not talking about bribe. Here's a couple bucks and, you know. But is there something that I'm pursuing in my heart that's causing me to compromise my integrity? Because your integrity is everything. And so we want to ask ourselves, am I chasing these things that will lead me, just like it did with this young man, and led him to death and destruction rather than life? He just should have stopped the chase, right? And I hear Jesus saying to you, saying to me, stop the chase. Close your eyes for a second. I want to lead you in a prayer. Then I'm going to go to the second word. We'll pray through that. Here's the scripture, the other prayer that I prayed, and I want to lead you in this. Holy Spirit, I am open to your whisper or your shout. Show me where I'm chasing something that is bad for me. Who are the relationships that I'm hoping for? One thing but getting another. I keep expecting and hoping for different results. Now hear the Lord say to you this. Here's what he said to my heart. Here's Jesus whispering to you tonight. Stop chasing after that in your heart, desires and hopes. Let it go. Hear Jesus say, let it go. Cease the pursuit now. Cease the pursuit now. It will only end in disappointment, destruction, or death of the relationship, the dream, or the passion. Redirect your passion, your focus, your heart on my pursuits for your life in this new season. Now hear Jesus, this word loud and clear. You can't move into this new thing till you let go of the old. I want you right now to say to Jesus, Lord, I'm willing If this is your truth, I want you to tell him, Lord, I'm willing to let go of the old to pursue the new. I want to run hard after you, God. I want to chase after you. For I know when I find you, I find fulfillment. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Turn to the person around you, both sides, and say this: stop the chase. Just tell them, stop the chase. Okay, let me give you the second word and we'll pray through it. This one I called unyoke. Unyoke. And it's found in 2 Chronicles 20, 35 to 37. Okay, here's the story. Just last week we read the story of Jehoshaphat, and I'll give you like the 1 minute Reader's Digest version. Jehoshaphat, you read the story how he was confronted by an enemy army that's way bigger than him. I mean, he was bound to lose this battle, but God shows out. And Jehoshaphat and the army doesn't even have to lift their weapons, and God does this miraculous thing, and man, it just looks like Jehoshaphat is just this hero. And I have preached this passage for 40 years. I have never seen the end of that, really read the end of that chapter. I always focused on the positive, the good. But there's an end to his story. And this is kind of bothers me because I'm getting a little older. There's a lot of guys in the Old Testament that don't finish well. They start getting gray beard and bald, and they just do dumb stuff. They don't end well. This has been my prayer for a couple of years. Jesus, I want to end well. I want to have fire in the belly, and I want to be a righteous man. I want to do things that please you and have a heart that's, you know, pursuing you. But I'm just telling you, read the Bible, and just so many great guys don't end well. Well, Jehoshaphat did the same stupid thing. Wow. I just noticed you have a Dallas Cowboys t-shirt on. That distracted me. Wow. I can't believe you wore that to God's house. Sorry. Squirrel. So, Jehoshaphat. Let's look at it. Verse 35, it says this. After this, Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, joined. Ever say joined? That means yoked, joined. He joined with Ahaziah, king of Israel, who acted wickedly. He joined him in building ships to go to Tarshish. What's in Tarshish? Gold, lots of it. And they built the ships in Ezion-Geber. Then Eliezer, the son of whoever that is, prophesied against Jehoshaphat, saying, because you have joined, this word three times, joined. We got to pay attention, it's there. Because you have yoked yourself, you have joined with Ahaziah, the Lord will destroy what you have made. And the ships were wrecked and were not able to go down to Tarshish. Again, three times. And this is the word of the Lord to me. It may not be to you, but I thought you may want to hear it. So here it is. The question is who are we yoked with in life? Who are we walking through life with? Because they're going to make us or break us. And you can be a righteous person, a good person, like Jehoshaphat was. I mean, just gosh, look what he did. But then for whatever reason, he thought to himself, I can yoke myself, be joined with King Ahaziah, who did what? Wicked. He was a perverted, evil man. But somehow we can go on this business venture to get a bunch of gold so that our pockets will be full. You know, somehow God will understand. And he partners up with, he yokes himself to this guy, and it ends badly. Here's what happens. God allows those ships that they had built to go get the gold, the enterprise, the business that they built, The business was destroyed. And they never did get the gold. Why? Because Jehoshaphat was yoked with the wrong person. Now listen carefully. And again, I'm talking to believers right now. Because Scripture talks a lot about who are you yoked with. Okay, we're talking about even when you get married. Scripture talks about be careful who you get married to. You're going to spend a lifetime with that person. You don't want to be unequally yoked. Right? Some of you, a lot of single folks in the room, you want to make sure when you're, you know, got that profile, you know, dating.com, whatever it is, and you're looking for the profile, make sure God's at the top of the list. Oh, but James, I love him and I can change him. No. Scripture talks a lot about that being unequally yoked. Paul said it this way. He said, do not be yoked together with unbelievers. This is in 2 Corinthians 6:14. Do not be yoked, or King James says unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? Or what fellowship can light have with darkness? What harmony is there between Christ and Belial, which is, you know, an image, an idol? Or what does a believer have in common with unbeliever? What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? For we are the temple of the living God. So here's what the Lord said to me. He said, James, review your life. As you're leaving this last season, you're entering into a brand new season. It's a season of rebuilding and doing some things that with new life. And you got to make sure that you're yoked up with the right people. I think the Lord would say to you tonight and says to me, we need to review those who are closest to us, those that we do life with. And again, you got to keep unbelievers around so you can love them and care for them and lead them to Christ and build those friendships. But I'm talking about the people that really speak into your life. You got to make sure that they have same values, similar values that you have. That when you get around them, they don't bring you down in your righteous living. They actually bring you up, and they elevate you and inspire you to be a better person, a more ethical person, a more moral person. Because you've heard me say this many times, but the friends closest to you are going to make you or break you. Right? Friends are like the buttons on the elevator. They'll bring you up or they'll bring you down. You can't soar with the eagles if you're running with the turkeys. So I got to review who is it in my life that maybe I can love them from a distance, but I don't need to be yoked to them. This is true in business. I've seen business partners be yoked together. One was a follower of Jesus. The other one was just evil. How does that work out? It doesn't work out in the long run. Why? Because they're unequally yoked. So here's the word of the Lord to me. And I want to show you a picture. Just go on down to Deuteronomy 22:10. Deuteronomy 22:10. I was going to give you some other scriptures, but I want to give you this one. It says, do not plow with an ox and a donkey yoked together. I got a picture. I hope they can show you. Because it really helps you to say, do not plow with an ox and a... I want you to look at that. The poor donkey, that's it. That's it. Poor donkey. Why? Because you have this huge ox that's bigger and stronger, and that poor little donkey, you know, he just cannot, you know, pull the same load as that oxen, and all of a sudden they're pulling against each other and all that's going on. So there in Deuteronomy says, don't plow the field with a donkey and an ox yoked together. Why? Because you're not going to make progress. You're going to wear yourselves out. It's not going to be any good. So here's the word of the Lord to you and to me. Is there an area in my life as I'm entering into this new season where I'm yoked unequally with somebody? Maybe there's got to be some review of my friendships and the people that are in my inner circle, because they are going to make or break you. It's like this. If I'm reaching down to, let's see, Lydia, come here just a second. If I'm reaching down to Lydia, my wife, and I'm trying to actually pull her up, you behave yourself. If I'm going to try to pull her up, is it easy for her to pull me down? Don't be mean. It's a whole lot easier for her to pull me down if she's down there, right? So if you're connected to people that are, you know, they don't have the same morals, the same guidelines, and they're not walking the same path. I'm going to pull them up, James. I promise you, you're probably not going to pull them up in the long haul because you're going to wear yourself out. Ultimately, they're going to pull you down. So the word of the Lord, thank you, and thank you for not pulling me down. Y'all think she's an angel. She's not. And I'm yoked to her. Next year, 40 years. So, anyways. I want us to pray through this. So would you bow your heads? As we begin this season, I don't know where you land. Maybe this word was just for me, but I don't think so. I think the Lord was speaking to some of us. Spirit of God, I hear in my heart right now the whisper of who I'm really yoked with. Jesus, I'm joined, I'm connected, I'm yoked with you. Hear Jesus say the words right now, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. Tell Jesus right now, say, Jesus, I want to be yoked to you and you alone. Lord, I trust you to set the pace for my life. Your yoke is easy, your burden is light. And Father, if there's a relationship in our lives that we're unequally yoked, help us to have the courage to move in a different direction. We can't move into the new thing until we let go of the old. Maybe there's some new friends that we need to develop in this community of faith. People of similar values that are moving in the right direction. And yes, still stay connected to those who are irreligious and far from God, to have a friendship with them. But those that we're going to do life with, Lord, help us to recognize who they are and to move into this new thing that you're doing. Thank you, Father. So, Lord Jesus, we want to stop the chase. And we want to be unyoked from that will slow us down or stop us from moving in the right direction. Holy Spirit, move now in our hearts. We commit this to you. I want you to join hands with the people that are beside you, around you. Just join hands. Would you do that? Hear God say to you these words, behold, I am doing a new thing. Behold, I do a new thing. The old is being done away with. The new is coming into your heart. The new is coming into your life. New Life Church, behold, I do a new thing in New Life Church. Something fresh and new. And we have to be willing to let go of the old and move into the new. So I want you to pray for the person that you're joining hands with. I want you to ask Jesus to help them to move into the new thing. Let's do that now. Let's pray for each other. Father, would you bless this person I've joined hands with new courage to move into their destiny, to move into this new season with confidence, knowing that you're doing something brand new, it's fresh, and it's something of your spirit. You're moving in our lives. You're moving in the world. And You're just looking for people who will be obedient to you, who will listen and obey and move in confidence. And Father, we pray for each other right now. There'll be fresh grace, fresh anointing, a fresh touch of your hand on us, Lord. So bless our friends right now. Bless our brothers and sisters. We pray this in Jesus' strong name. Amen. 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 All right. Let's stand up, would you please? New Life, you guys are the best. You really are. I just love our journey together. I love digging all of you Cowboy fans. Has that running back signed yet? Oh, that's terrible. Y'all love me. You know you do. I want to tell you something, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart. Hear me as I speak to you from the heart of Jesus. There really is something brand new. And I declare to you in the name of Jesus, you're moving into a new destiny, a new season. And I'm not talking about a repaired old. I'm talking about a brand new season. Freshness of God, a new thing, a new thing. So be expecting it. It's going to be a powerful season. Amen. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus of Nazareth, I bless this church family. I thank you for all of them. I thank you for our many campuses and how we come together as your family, as a New Life family. And Lord, we join with all the other churches in Bakersfield saying, come kingdom of God to our city. Rule and reign in Bakersfield. Father, and use us to be light and salt in this world that is just spinning with hate. Lord, let us let your love flow through this city. Let us love the unlovely. Help us, Lord, to reach out to those people who are so different from us. Lord, help us to celebrate our differences. Help us to fill our neighborhoods and our city, the city and the schools and everything. Lord, fill it with your kindness and your patience and your love. So then the world will look at us and say, oh, they're followers of Jesus. Love through us, Lord. Love through us. In your strong name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you guys.